Harsh Saptalkar. I'm studying in SEGAB Institute of Engineering and Technology, Vijaipur, in Electrical and Electronics branch in 4th sem. Subject name, Transmission and Distribution. Let us come to the point. We'll discuss the topic, difference between underground system and overhead system. First, underground system. Transmission is by the cable, using by cables. In underground system, transmission is by using the transmission lines. In overhead system, all the cables must be properly insulated from each other. In underground system, the appropriate spacing provided between the conductors acts as an insulation. Externally, insulation is necessary. Point. In overhead system, let us come to the underground system. The insulation cost is very high, and overhead system, no insulation here. Cost is air cost at an insulator in overhead system. And transmission over long distance is not a possible, as laying in the cables is difficult, costly and complicated. In underground system, transmission over long the distance is possible with the help of transmission line. In overhead system, it is a very safe due to a insulation used in underground system, and the conductors are bare without the insulation, hence dangerous. In overhead system, the size of the cables are very high. In underground system, the size of the conductors is very less. In overhead system, let us, one more point is, in underground system, here voltage drop is very less compared to the overhead system, and the voltage drop is very more in overhead system as compared to the underground system. The beauty of the area, towns, etc., as well as the maintained in underground system, the beauty of the area gets affected due to the overhead lines. Sometimes trees are required to be cut, etc., happens in rainy season, much more rainy season. And last stuff is, last point is, the maintenance cost is very less in underground transmission line system, and the maintenance cost is much more in overhead system. We discuss in comparison of the underground system and overhead system. Shall we wind up this topic? Thank you. Last point is, the maintenance cost is very less in underground transmission line system, and the maintenance cost is much more in overhead system. We discuss in comparison of the underground system and overhead system. Shall we wind up this topic? Thank you.
Myself, Prashant Siddhi, Department of Electrical and Electronic Engineering. My topic name is Protection, Overhead Line Protection Against Lightning. First of all, I am explaining what is lightning. Lightning is an electrical discharge in air between clouds, between the separate charges centers in the same cloud, under or between cloud and the earth, is called as lightning. So this lightning contains the high voltage, high current. So effect of the lightning on transmission line, the first effect is damage the equipment connected to the transmission line. The second effect is it is caused to the breakdown of the insulator, and third effect is it damage the conductor and caused to the breakdown of the conductor. So to overall this reduce the lightning effect, we are used three systems. First is earthing screen, second is ground wires, and third is lightning arrestor or surge diverters. Lightning earthing screen to provide the protection for the generating station and substation, we are used the earthing screen. Overhead ground wire protects the direct lightning stroke, protect transmission line from the direct lightning strokes. Third one, arrestor, the protection against both kind of the strokes, direct soap or indirect strokes or the traveling waves, are provided by the lightning arrestors. Types of lightning arrestor. First, horn grab arrestor. It is consist of two parallel rod iron rods in the shape of cow horn. It is used in the 11 kV transmission line. Second type is metal oxide valve type or MOV. It is used to protect the 220 kV transmission line. And third one is a pellet type lightning arrestor. It is modified version of MOV type lightning arrestor. It is used in 66 kV line protection. Fourth one is a thyroid lightning arrestor. Its construction is similar to the pellet lightning arrestor and it is used to protection of the 220 kV transmission line.
Myself Anas. My topic is overhead line protection against lightning. All the electrical equipment must be protected from severe damage due to the lightning stroke. The problem of protection of power system against lightning can be studied. Number one, protection of power station and substation from direct lightning stroke. Number two, protection of overhead transmission line from direct lightning stroke. And number three, protection of electrical equipment from traveling waves. Number one, protection of power station and substation from direct lightning stroke. Power station are usually indoor while substation may be indoor or outdoor. For protection of a structure from direct stroke, there are three requirements which are to be fulfilled. These requirements are interception, conduction and dissipation. Number two, protection of overhead transmission line from direct lightning stroke. The two methods of protecting overhead transmission line against lightning stroke are advertisement. Number one, overhead ground wire, and number two, explosion.
Good afternoon everyone. Myself Sasleem and I am student of the SIT studying in 4SEM under the electrical department. Today I want to explain the topic of the calculation of sag and detention. The subtopic is the support at equal legal. So let's start.
Support of the equal legum representation. Let's start the derivation. Consider a conductor. Supported A and B. Which are located at the same level. Let the O be the point on the trajectory mathematically it can be proved that the O is the mid span. Let L be the length of the span. In meter, W be the weight per unit length of the conductor. Let T be the tension in the conductor. In kg. The length of a span capital L is large compared to sag S. Small L is the half span length is equals to capital L divided by 2. Taking the two force momentum of these two forces, about the point P. Therefore, T into Y is equals to WX into X divided by 2. Y, therefore, Y is equals to W into X, X square divided by 2T. Therefore, at A or B, X are equals to small L equals to capital L divided by 2 and y is equals to S. So S is equals to W divided by 2T, where X is equals to L divided by 2 whole square is equals to W L square divided by 4 8 8 8T. Capital L is the total span length. Capital T is the tension of the conductor. The sag at any point O, for S minus Y is equals to WL square divided by 8T minus WX square divided by 2T. Therefore, sag is equals to W divided by 8T L square minus 4X square.
Hi guys, this is me Muskan from 4th sem electrical and my USN number is 2SA1800009. On 2nd May, I am going to explain the topic about overhead transmission line. And the transmission system depends upon the various factors like resistance, capacitance and inductance. And depending upon these values, the voltage drop along with the line will be changed. And resistance plays a very important role to consider a power loss in line and in efficiency. And the resistance, capacitance and inductance is distributed uniformly along with the line. And the capacitance plays a role important. In single phase circuit, the capacitance plays between the conductors. But in three phase circuits, the conductor to neutral path forms a shunt path. And there is a different types of overhead transmission lines, like short transmission line, medium transmission line and long transmission line. In a short transmission line, the line length should be 50 km and the voltage drop should be less, about 50 kV, about 50 kV, and on this the line is treated as a short transmission line. In this, the if length is small and voltage drop is also small, then capacitive effect will be neglected. Due to this, the capacity will be neglected. Only resistance and inductance should be considered. Next is medium transmission line. In medium transmission line, the line kilometer to 100 km and the voltage drop should be moderately high, about 50 kV to 100 kV. Between this, the line is should be treated as a medium transmission line. Then next is a long transmission line. In long transmission line, the length of the line should be more than 100 km old, and the voltage drop should be high and about 100 kV, more than 100 kV old, and line is treated as a long transmission line. Then this is a representation of transmission line. This is a generator which is supplied the load, which supplies the load, and the resistance and inductance makes the impedance, and these are connected to the each phase of the generator. And in a short transmission line, the inductance and resistance are lumped or not lumped. There is no make difference. And this is a medium transmission line. This is a medium transmission line. In this, the shunt conductance G is neglected because the same current flow throughout the circuit to calculate the voltage and resistance. And this is about the overhead transmission lines. And thank you for watching this video.
Hello sir, good morning. Myself Priyanka Kokar. I studied in the 4th Electrical Department. Today I shall discuss one topic, vibration of a conductor and a damper from the overhead transmission line. The conductors are supported on the string insulator at a tower, at each tower. Under varying atmospheric conditions like spin velocities, the conductor can vibrate. In such vibrations, can have different velocities, amplitude. In this case, two types of vibrations, which are those? One is a yaw-line vibration, second one is a galloping. One more name of a galloping is the dancing of a conductor. And now I shall discuss both vibrations. First one is a yaw-line vibration. The yaw-line vibration have a frequency range of 8 to 40 hertz with the amplitude varying between the 2 to 5 centimeter. These are the high frequency, low amplitude. The wind velocity is of about 2 to 40 km per hour can generate a vibration. One standard formula is the frequency of a yaw-line vibration, that is F alpha equal to 2 times Vp divided by D into 10^3, where Vp is the wind velocity which is measured in a kilometer per hour, and D is the diameter of the conductor which is measured in a meter. Some conductors are used, such as bundle conductors, proper design and locations of spacers and clamps, and some dampers are used minimize the effect of yaw-line vibration. And second one is galloping vibration. The galloping means dancing of conductor at a low frequency and high amplitude. These are the oscillations. Oscillations is a span of a conductor, complete on span of a conductor. It causes the longitudinal movement of a conductor through the conductor clamps. And the range of a galloping is 2.25 to 1.5 hertz, with amplitude is very high in this compared to the yaw-line vibration, that is 6 meter. Galloping is very rare, but in possible in rainy season and snowfall conditions, apart from the icing conditions. Galloping is restricted, but in icing condition, height of the conductor properly designed, considering the amplitude of the possible galloping. The galloping vibrations are longitudinal, horizontal configuration of the conductor for avoiding the clashing of a conductor during the galloping. This is all about the vibration of the conductor and damper. Thank you so much.
discussed about the insulator properties of insulator and insulator materials. First one is meaning of insulator. Insulator is a substance or device which does not readily conduct any electricity. Next, use of insulator. Insulator to avoid the flow of current to the earth from live conductor through support. Next, discussed about the properties of insulator. First one is the insulator along with provide insulations also provide support to the conductor. The insulator must be mechanically strong. The main function of insulator to resist any leakage current. The insulator must be free from internal impurities such as holes, cracks and laminations etc. to reduce the permittivity of insulators. The insulators dielectric strength is very high. Permittivity of the insulator material should also have a very high. The insulator should be a non-porous. Non-porous means do not allow any liquid or air pass through it. The insulator do not affect it from the change the temperature. Now discussed about the insulator materials. First one is porcelain, second one is glass, third one is synthetic resin. First one is porcelain. Porcelain is a ceramic material manufactured from the China clay. China clay is a soil, type of a soil. The porcelain have a high resistance. The dielectric strength about the porcelain is 60 kilovolt per centimeter. The porcelain free from the holes, cracks, lamination, etc. Now discussed about the glass. Glass is made by tough heat treatment which is called as annealing. Glass have some advantages. These are, first one is glass is transparent, so holes, cracks and other defects are there, we can easily find out it. Next, resistance is very high, cheaper than the porcelain. Compressed strength is very high, so coefficient of temperature is also low, so it is changes the temperature does not affect, so it is very useful. Glass have some disadvantage, that is less stronger than the porcelain. Next, discussed about the synthetic resin. Synthetic resin is a manufactured from compound of silicon, rubber and resin. Synthetic resin have some advantages. These are tensile strength is very high, weight is very low and these have cheaper than the porcelain and glass. This is having some limitations, that is a high leakage current and short lifetime, not good for using the insulator. Next advantages is completed, then the limitations is completed. Next, applications of synthetic resin is indoor and bushings are use that synthetic resin. Thank you.
Hello everyone, myself Srishti Gadmani, student of SICAB Institute of Engineering and Technology. I selected the branch Electrical and Electronic Engineering. I am studying in 4th semester, where I got the topic of over transmission lines. I selected the subtopic as a type of line conductors, wherein there are types of conductors which are used in the transmission lines. Firstly, mainly we will discuss about ACSR, that is nothing but aluminium conductor with a steel reinforced. The mechanical strength that is obtained from the conductors is made up of aluminium alloy. This is overcome by adding a steel core to the conductors. There are seven steel strands which form the central core, and these are surrounded by the 30 aluminium strands. Current capacity and the resistance of the conductor is dependent on the conductivity of the aluminium. The ACSR conductor is most widely used because they have certain advantages. Firstly, that due to high mechanical and tensile strength, and second one is they have long lifespan, and third one they have less corona loss is less, and fourth one is skin effect is less. Now we'll discuss about AAAC, that is nothing but all aluminium alloy conductor. This conductor are made from aluminium alloy. This conductor are suitable for urban areas as they provide better tensile strength and conductivity. Some of these alloys are costly as they are heat related. One of the alloy aluminium is known as silimic, which contains 0.5 silicon and 0.5% of the magnesium, and rest of is aluminium. Then we'll discuss about AAAC, that is nothing but all alloy conductor. Due to increasing of copper, aluminium is used in the transmission lines. The cross section area of aluminium conductor is greater than that of the copper. Hence the transportation is economical. Corona effect is reduced due to increase in the diameter of the conductor. These conductors are used in the distribution. Now, the ACSR and AAAC and AAAC is nothing but they are used in the low temperature. Now, we'll discuss about the conductors used for the high temperatures. Thermal resistance aluminium alloy. This is similar to that of the ACSR, same related to the ACSR. The change of EC grade is aluminium wires are replaced by hard drawn aluminium wires of heat resistance. Aluminium also known as TAL. Now we'll discuss about features of the TSAAR, which have high capacity of the current carrying capacity. Now it is a good mechanical and electrical. They got a good electrical and mechanical property for related or acquired temperature. Required temperature, very stable at high temperature, and they have cost effective designs.
Good morning, sir. Myself Sanya Afrin from 4th Sem. My topic is the support supporting the conductor are located at unequal levels. If we put two supports at unequal levels, then sag and tension will be present in the conductor. What is the meaning of sag? Sag is the difference in level point of support, and the level lowest point on the conductor is called sag. In any situation, practically it is not possible to have the support at the same level. It is necessary to use the support at the different levels in the areas, small hills, rivers, etc.
This is the diagrammatic representation of the support at unequal levels. L is the total span length. H is difference in the level. T is the tension present in the conductor. X1 is distance point O from support A. X2 is distance of point O from support B. W is the weight per unit length of the conductor. S1 equal to WX1 square divided by 2T. This is the sag present at A support. This is clearly explained in the equal levels. S2 is equal to WX2 square divided by 2T. This is sag present at support B. Sum of X1 and X2 will give total span length L. X1 plus X2 is equal to L. Subtract equation 1 from 2. This S1 and S2 subtraction. S2 minus S1 is equal to W divided by 2T is common from both the equations. X2 whole square minus X1 whole square. X2 square minus X1 whole square will give X2 minus X1, X2 plus X1. W divided by 2T, X2 minus X1, and X2 plus X1 gives you L. This is S2 minus S1. Difference between the points, difference between the two sacks S1 and S2 is also the difference in the levels. S2 minus S1 is gives H. This is S1 and S2. S2 minus S1 gives you this length H. Subtract equation 5 in 4. This is equation number 5 and this is equation number 4. H is equal to WL divided by 2T X2 minus X1. X2 minus X1 is equal to H into 2T divided by W into L. Solving equation 3 and 6. This is equation 6 and this is equation number 3. By solving these two equations, we get 2X1 is equal to L minus 2TH divided by WL. X1 is equal to L divided by 2 minus 2th divided by 2wl. These two cancels. X1 is equal to L divided by 2 minus th divided by wl, and x2 is equal to L divided by 2 plus th divided by wl. These two will gives this x1 and x2 are known. The sags s1 and s2 can be determined easily.
Myself Shahista from EEE department. Firstly, a special thanks to our HOD and our teachers who are making too much efforts for understanding the topic. Now my topic is overhead line insulator. Why we need overhead line insulator? We seen that the overhead line insulator are the bare conductors covered with the insulator for a supporting structure. It is called razor tower that will carry the conductor to isolate this conductor to restrict that current that can flow from the conductor to the earth body. And for isolates, we have to use insulator. There must be a clearance between the line conductors and the supports. The insulator are fitted with the arcing horns. Now we have a discussion about the types of insulator. There are 5 types of insulator. First one is pin type, suspension type, shackle type and stay type. First one is pin type insulator. I drawn some picture for our understanding purpose. Pin type insulator. It is used for 11 kV voltages, but for higher voltage like 33, 45, 66, beyond it to 2 or 3 pin types of are used. On the upper there is a groove house conductor. And these pin type insulator are restricted up to the 33 kV. Now the second one is suspension type insulator. It is also called as a disc insulator, which is connected one after another in a series metallic structure. It will spring suspension of insulator. It is used for a higher voltage and its maintenance is very easy compared to the pin type insulator. And in cheap, it is cheaper in cost. And the next insulator is string type insulator. These insulator are used when there is a dead end of the line or corner or line is at a sharp curve on it, maybe a crossing the river, etc. Now the next is shackle type insulator. These are also called as a spool insulator. These are primary used for a low voltages. These insulator can be used in a horizontal position, in a vertical position. These shackle type insulator are in a round shape. Now the last one is stay type insulator. These insulator are also called as a egg type insulator. In case of low voltage line, the stays are to be insulated and the height is not less than 3 meter. These insulator are used to stay the stay clamp and creates insulation between stay clamp. And this is the last.
Good day, sir. Myself Saba. I am from 4th Sem Electrical Department, and today's my topic is advantages of high voltage transmission line. Basically, the transmission line are those line which consist of a high voltage, which delivers electricity over a long distance. And coming to my topic, that is advantages of high voltage transmission line. The transmission lines are used of high voltage because it increase efficiency and the power losses will be reduced, and it will minimize the power losses, and the efficiency and the voltage regulation is good. The primary reason that power is transmitted at the high voltage is to increase the efficiency. The losses will be reduced because of high voltage lines. Minimize the power loss due to resistance in the conductor. Reduction in the volume of the conductor. Decrease in voltage drop and improvement of voltage regulation. Increase power handling capacity. The power handling capacity also be increased. And the main reason that the voltage is transmitted at the high voltage is because of it improves its efficiency. Because of the high voltage, the efficiency will be good and the power losses will be minimized, and power handling capacity is very
Hello everyone, my name is Deepa Rathod, studying in CCAP IIT College, Vijaypur. Today I shall take a topic which may help us in our in-all exams, that is supporting structures of overhead transmission lines. So let's start with that. These are generally called as towers. They give support to the overhead transmission lines, and the design of towers is important in power systems. Why? Because the towers, the performance of the transmission lines is totally depends on the design of towers itself. So the towers must be designed in such a way that they can carry the load of conductors and insulators for extreme loading condition. Okay, now what are the basic requirements of towers? That's also important, right? So first one is must be mechanically strong, so that it must be capable of carrying the loads of conductors and insulators for extreme load. And the second one is maintenance cost must be low. And the third one is must be light in weight, so that the transportation cost can be saved. And the important thing is must have longer lifespan. Must be economical, should not affect the appearance of locality, must have minimum number of members, okay? And the erection of conductors is also very important. It should be available easily for erection of conductors. So these are all basic requirements of towers. Now we shall see about various types of towers. So there are four types of towers. First one is wooden poles. These are simplest and cheapest in nature and used for low voltage levels and for distribution purposes. And these are not used for transmission purpose. Why? Because they undergo decomposition and have shorter life and elastic in nature. And precaution is there for decomposition. That is, metallic cap is used at the top of the towers, so to protect it from decay, and the underground part of the tower is properly preserved. Now, second one is reinforced concrete towers. Okay, nowadays these towers are very popular because they are mechanically strong, maintenance cost is also low, and they have longer lifespan and attractive in appearance. Okay, and the disadvantage of these towers is they are heavy in load, and so tower transportation cost is also high, and these are used for systems up to 33 kV voltage levels. Third one is steel tubular power towers. These towers are specially designed for high and very extra high voltage levels. Okay, and due to steel towers, they're used to steel tubes. Due to steel tubes, they have longer lifespan and have low base area. Actually, these towers have low base area. So these towers are used for only those localities where base area is considered as a main point or important. And these are also used for the systems up to 33 kV voltage levels. Now fourth one is lattice steel structures or towers. These are specially designed for, or generally, these are generally self-supporting broad-based structures. Okay, and here galvanized steel tubes are used as a towers, and these are also mechanically strong. Maintenance cost is also low, and light in weight. Lattice structures were light in weight and economical, and these are useful for crossing the rivers, valleys, etc. Okay. And these lattice steel structures are further classified into three types, that is self-supporting, guide V-type and connect type structures. Okay, and the main disadvantage of these towers is more right of way, and so these are used for voltage, very high voltage lines. Okay, and I have some structures of those types of towers. That is, these are the structure, these are the four structures of lattice steel towers itself, and this is the structure of steel tubular towers. Okay, I think all concepts were clear, so thank you very much. Best regards, Deepa.
Good afternoon everyone. So myself is Sayed Mohammad Yoskaran Jalikar. So today discussing about the insulator, introduction of insulator and properties of insulator and materials of insulator and types of insulator. So first discussing about the what do you mean by insulator. The insulator is a metallic structure in the form of tower, is used to live conductor and supports such as supports to avoid the flow of current to the earth from a live conductor through the supports, and the safe clearance between conductor and supports. This is also called as insulator. Next one, properties of insulator. The main function of insulator should not be affected by change in temperature. The dielectric strength of insulator should be high. The insulator is internal impurity, is holes, cranes, lamination, etc. Next one is materials of insulator. First one is porcelain and synthetic resin and glass. These materials are used. Then types of insulator. There are six types of insulator. First one is pin type insulator and suspension type insulator and stay type insulator and shackle type insulator and last one is suspension and stray pin type insulator. So this is all about the introduction of insulator and properties of insulator and the materials of insulator and then types of insulator. So thank you.
Myself, Khizar Ahmad, Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering. My topic is arcing horns. I will explain one by one in brief. First of all, I explain what is meant by arcing horns. Arcing horns are the metal rod constructed in the form of projection on the both side of the insulator. Next, why it is used? Where there is a lightning surge occurs, the arcing horns prevent the arc formation across the insulator. By conducting the arc across the insulator, for this to happen, the gap between the horns must be much less than the length of the insulator string. Where it is placed, the horns have large spread on the both side. For an example, on the transmission tower side and conducting the line of an insulator. Where it occurs. When there is a lightning surge occur, the arcing horn prevent the formation across the insulator by conducting the arc across them. For the horns must be less than the length of the insulator string. What is the main function of arcing horns? The main function of the arcing horns is to bypass the high voltage across the arcing horns. The small air gap between the arcing horns is responsible to conduct the over voltage surge through it, and it avoids the damage of the insulator. Next, and the question may arise, how it avoids the damage? The horns are normally paired either side of an insulator, and one connected to the high voltage and other connected to the ground. Next, then the one more question will arise, why we use instead of lightning arrester arcing horns? The arcing horns are much cheaper than the lightning arrester. Lightning arrester are very costly.
Myself Geeta Chauhan. I am taking insulator materials. There are three types of insulator materials: porcelain, glass, synthetic resin. Now we have to discuss about porcelain. This is the most commonly used material for insulators. It is a ceramic material. It is manufactured from a China clay. It is covered with a glaze. The cast iron and galvanizing is used for metallic part inside the insulators. Porcelain is free from crack holes and laminations. It is insulation resistance is very its insulation resistance is very high. Porcelain is heated at the temperature such that insulators becomes mechanically strong, and it also remains non-porous. Rough surface catches the dust and moisture very quickly. Hence, it is important to provide glass surface to the insulators so that remains clean and clean from dust and moisture. Now discuss about the glass. The glass is also used instead of a porcelain. The glass is made through a heat treatment which is called annealing. Glass has some advantages and disadvantages. Now we have to discuss about the advantages. What are those advantages? Now, first advantage is that the dielectric strength is very high and low coefficient of thermal expansion, hence less affected by the temperature changes. Cheaper than the porcelain, and the resistivity is very high. Simple design is possible. Higher compression strength than porcelain. It has some disadvantages. Now we have to discuss about the disadvantages of glasses. Disadvantages first, there is a chances of a moisture condensation on the surface are high, which can causes the higher leakage current. High leakage of a current, and less stronger than the porcelain. In a high tension system, the heavy mass of a insulator can cause internal strain. Cannot be molded in a irregular shape. Now we have to discuss about that is a third material, synthetic material. Synthetic resin is insulated or manufactured from compound of silicon, rubber, resin, extra. Advantages, the tensile strength is high, the weight is low, and comparatively cheaper than the glass and porcelain. It has some disadvantages, high leakage of current and short circuit agutte.
My name is Mubashira Mir Jamadar. I am studying BE 4th sem. My topic name is properties of insulator. The insulating material must be free internal impurities such as holes, cracks, lamination, etc. to reduce the permittivity of the insulating material. The dielectric strength of the insulating material must be very high. To have high dielectric strength, the relative permittivity of the insulating material is very high. The insulation should be non-porous. The insulating should not be affected from the changing by the temperature. Insulating materials, there are three types: porcelain, glass, and synthetic resin. Porcelain, it is a commonly used material of insulating material. The porcelain is a free cracks or holes lamination. The porcelain is heated temperature by the insulating mechanically. The glass is instead of porcelain. The glass is made up by tau heated by the treatment is called enaming. The advantages of the glass, the simple design is possible. The dielectric strength is high. The cheaper is the porcelain. The synthetic resin is a insulating material. The synthetic resin is manufactured by the compound such as silicon, rubber, etc. The advantages of glass is the strength, the dielectric, the low, the weight is low, the comparatively is cheaper, the tensile strength is very high.
Myself Mahatab Alam from E&D department, 4th semester. My topic name is types of insulator. Basically, insulator is made up of porcelain, glass, synthetic resin material. The use of proper insulator is important part of the mechanical design of the overload lines. The various types of insulator are pin insulator, suspension insulator, strain insulator, shackle insulator, stay insulator. I will explain each type of insulator in brief. The first one, pin type of insulator. For lower voltage up to 11 kV, generally one piece pin type insulator is used. But for higher voltage like 33 kV, 45 kV, 66 kV, the 2-pin piece, 3-pin piece, 4-pin piece types insulator are used. Suspension type insulator. The second one is suspension type insulator. These insulator have number of porcelain disc units. These units are connected to one another in series with the help of metal links. These forms a string of porcelain disc. Each unit is designed for the low voltage, for say 11 kV. But as a string of such units give us proper insulation against very high voltage levels. It consists of a single disc shaped piece of porcelain. At the bottom, it is grooved so as to increase the flash over distance. The main drawback of this type of this cubical expansion of three material iron. The next one is strain insulator. These insulator are used. There is dead end of the line or corner, or line is at sharp curve, or the line is crossing the river, etc. For high voltage, strain insulator are used. The disc of the insulator are in vertical plane instead of the horizontal plane as in the suspension insulator. The next one I will explain the shackle insulator. These are also called spool insulator. These insulator can be used in horizontal position or in vertical position. These type of insulator are used at the dead end of the aerial wire of service connection to a house or a factory where there is excessive mechanical stress on the line. The next one is stay insulator. The stay insulator are also called egg insulator. In case of low voltage line, it is necessary that the stays are to be insulated of a height of not less than 3 meter from the ground. It is usually made up of porcelain. It has two holes for the stray wires and the design is such that increase the insulator breaks, then the stray wire will not fall on the ground. Thank you very much.
Supra Patil, 4th SEM, Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering from SICAB Institute of Engineering Technology. Today I am discussing about the typical line diagram of the transmission distribution scheme. So let us see the diagram how it is. This is the line diagram of a typical transmission distribution scheme. You can see there is a generating station 11 kV and it has two transformers that are step up transformer and step down transformer, and it has the secondary transmissions and primary transmissions. So let us know about this diagram briefly. This is the complete flow of an electrical power from the generating stations to the consumer premises. Let us study the line diagram of a such a typical scheme of transmission and distribution and discuss the various components and voltage levels at the various stages in detail. At the generating station, an electrical power is generated with the help of three phase alternator running in parallel. In the scheme shown, the voltage level is 11 kV, but the voltage level may be 6.6 kV, 22 kV or 33 kV depending upon the capacity of the generating station. After the generating station, actual transmission distribution starts. The overall scheme can be divided into four sections, which are primary transmission, secondary transmission, primary distribution and secondary distribution. Let us know about the primary transmission line. It is basically with the help of overhead transmission line. For the economic aspects, the voltage level is increased to 132 kV or 232 kV or more with the help of step up transformer. Hence this transformer is also called as high voltage transformers. Let us know about the secondary transmission line. The primary transmission line continues via transmission towers till the receiving stations. At the receiving station, the voltage level reduced to 12 kV, 22 kV or 33 kV using step-down transformer. The conductors used for secondary transmission are called feeders. Is primary distribution. At the substation, the voltage level is reduced to the 6.6 kV or 3.3 kV or 11 kV with the help of step-down transformer. It uses the three-phase, three-wire underground system, and further the power is transmitted to the local distribution centers, and it is also called as the high voltage distribution. Last one is the secondary distribution. At the load distribution center, there are step-down distribution transformer. The voltage level of 6.6 kV and 11 kV is further raised to 400 volt using distribution transformer. Sometimes it may be reduced to 230 volt. The power is then transmitted using distributor and service mains to the consumers. This is also called as the low. This is also called as low voltage distribution. This uses three phase four wire system. And this is all about the typical line diagram of typical transmission distribution scheme. Thank you.